It is really my pleasure to introduce Eelco Hooftman, who he was actually born in Holland, but has been living in Scotland for the last 20 years or so. A lot of the work, he's a founding co-partner of Grossmax, and a lot of the work that they do is predominantly in Europe, the Middle East, as well as Asia. He has quite a teaching resume along with a project portfolio. He teaches every fall at Harvard, as well as has many positions around Europe and lecturing opportunities. I think you'll really enjoy this lecture tonight. We had a wonderful luncheon with him where he wooed many, many civic leaders. But I think one of the important things about Eelco is something that he wrote in his bio, which is all of their work has the Dutch sense of experimentation, the British sense of humor, and the German rigor. So I'll leave it up to you to decide that. And without any further ado, I would like to introduce Eelco.
Well, it's great to be here, and I just had the opportunity to walk in this Walker Art Center for a couple of hours, and I was like a child in a sweet shop. It's fantastic. But I also bought a book, like a telephone book in the bookshop. So if I get bored in my own lecture, I will start reading. But the funny thing is, the book is called Reading the American Landscape, right? And it's pretty sharp, it's pretty cool. And then it's all produced by the Dutch, you know, Dutch writers, Dutch photographers, Dutch graphic designers. So be aware that Dutch are taking over. Before I start, I have to make a confession. I'm actually having a kind of sadomasochistic relationship, you know, love-hate with architects. You know, architects with their towering egos, their tunnel visions. Well, we all know about it. And I am more like this. I'm a gardener. I'm a landscape architect. And we are a bit more down to earth, thinking about space, time, in a slightly more philosophical way. It's about the process of transformation. As a landscape architect, we never have a tabula rasa. The tabula rasa is for the megalomaniac architect. We always are writing chapters in a book. So we're having to respond to context, space and time, and do that in a kind of slightly more humble way. Having said so, and that this is only the guy I introduced for tonight, because I'm officially to be asked to talk about our Tempelhof airport project, which I kept for the very for the very end. But I also, of course, cannot deny the idea of action man, the idea of not the kind of world of architecture and landscape, but the idea of being above it all. And in a funny way, my father was in aviation. He was in the aeroplane business. And I like to look to the world from above. I sometimes call ourselves, in our Grossmax practice, the children of the Google Earth revolution. You know, we're zooming in, zooming out. I mean, having this kind of big perspective because of not only the aerial view, but all our latest techniques. I really like this this map of Europe at night, the satellite photograph. First of all, it doesn't show any boundaries, no political boundaries, but it also shows that the whole of Europe is one big urban constellation. And for me, this is very interesting. When I was educated as a landscape architect, I was educated at the agricultural university. I was surrounded by farmers' sons and daughters, and we are the kind of strange, odd one out. But the idea of, and when I was being educated, it was all about countryside and rural land use. And I was much more, as a young punk, interested in the city and city life. And I think time has caught up, and all nearly all our work, and I think most work of landscape architects these days, are actually urban projects. And two, I'm very interested and inspired by cinema, and these are two of my favorite films. On the left, Draftsman Contract, Peter Greenaway. On the right, Blown Up by Antonioni. But I show you those pictures. I show you the Greenaway, because the draftsman contract. It's about framing. It's about drawing the landscape. And I think very much my tradition of landscape goes back to the idea of drawing the landscape as a form of art, the landscape art. But I also like the notion of what we see in the Blown Up series. It's about, as a landscape architect, you have to be a bit like a detective. You have to be able to zoom in, and not only as Google Earth zooming out, being telescopic, but also sometimes being microscopic, and really analyze what goes on. This is a bit of a sentimental slide. This is my hometown in the Netherlands, the city of Haarlem, painted by Ruisdael. And of course, I like this painting. Look at this kind of very flat landscape, the straight horizon, this kind of pregnant sky, and this kind of punctuation of the churches on the skyline. And my God, in Holland, you have to be religious. It's compulsory. It is true, because we are living, I mean, this is 6 meters below sea level. All right. So if you don't believe in God, you know, you either have to be an optimist or you're in big trouble. But I also like this slide because the landscape in the front, on one hand we see nature, like the stream, but also we see the bleaching of the linen on the fields, which is like in those days an industrial activity. So already in the 17th century, landscape and townscape are kind of intertwined, a kind of continuing product. You know, there is no clear distinction for me between landscape and townscape. They're kind of intertwined and part of the same spectrum. And this slide is actually, if I go back, that big church on the horizon, I take you now by another painting, Saradam, who painted the interior of this church. And I really like this church. It's about all about space, it's about light, it's about volume, it's about void. And still, it's still humanistic, you know. The view is not symmetric, it's asymmetric. We got the child, the doggy, the kind of movable pieces of furniture. It's, you know, it's a humanistic Protestant kind of space. But architecture, of course, is all a play of light. And the next slide, again, another painter, now standing next to the town hall, looking back towards the church across the marketplace. So here we got it all. We got the church, which is religion. We got the marketplace, which is economy. And we got the town hall, which is all about politics. And that is, of course, all the ingredients which make civic space. And the reason I show you this is because to talk about this sequence, and for me, it kind of sums up the spectrum, the field of operation of being a landscape architect. It goes from landscape to architecture. And I really quite like this word landscape architecture, which is my profession, to break down in those three components. It's about land, it's about scape, giving shape, and it's about architecture in its own right. Another one of my Dutch heroes is, of course, Vermeer. There are not that many paintings by Vermeer. There's only about 20 odd one left around. And what I really feel intrigued about is that a lot of those paintings by Vermeer got the Dutch map on the background, on the wall. And I think this is very fascinating. It shows that the making of the land itself, was already a kind of commodity and something to be proud of and something, you know, literally to put as a painting on the wall. It also, of course, gives a kind of geographic disposition of the whole setting of the painting. And all what I've done here is to do a bit of Photoshop and add the new map of the Netherlands. But still, if you look at it, you know, look here, it's all water and swamp. And, you know, Holland is, of course, a delta landscape. It's the leftovers of Germany. It's a kind of a continuous flux. And the Dutch have been beavering away and creating land out of the sea, you know, we creating our own landscape. And that's also very much the way how I was educated and being brought up. And even, you know, look at this this picture of Amsterdam. And it's a funny way, it's the concentric, organically grown Amsterdam. It's nearly like a fetus in the embryo in the fetus. The landscape itself, look to the agricultural land, is even more rational, even more man-made than a townscape. And so here's my home country, the Dutch landscape, like a total work of art. And every square centimeter is being planned, discussed, and being designed. And a landscape like this, it's only got about a lifespan of 20 years, and then you start all over again and reorganize and regroup. And of course, that leads to this kind of strange Dutch conceptual way of doing art. And this book is one of the examples about that. You know, it's a kind of antidote trying to escape this kind of straitjacket of the functional landscape. And it, of course, it needs to be a German to tell the truth about the Dutch. And as you probably know, there are good Germans and bad Germans. But this is Joseph Beuys, and he was a good one. And he told a fantastic story about the Dutch landscape. Basically, he told, and this were his words, it's not mine, but basically he said, "You Dutch, you really screwed it up big times." You know, and basically he was saying that the Dutch has reclaimed so much land out of the sea that we Dutch lost the liquid mirror. So we lost this kind of beautiful reflective qualities of light bouncing on the Dutch landscape. And according to Beuys, that reflective aquatic landscape was the origin of the Dutch art, the Dutch golden age of paintings like Rembrandt, Vermeer, and Ruysdael, some of you know that I showed you. And by taking too much water away out of our land, we lost that kind of liquid mirror, the eye, as Joseph Beuys called it. And since that happened, especially in the last century, according to Joseph Beuys, the Dutch has not produced any visual art of any importance anymore. So, and I like this idea. I like this idea that there's a direct correlation between the lay of the land and the visual art being produced in the landscape. So again, this kind of shows this kind of strange Dutch landscape of natural and man-made forces in a kind of continuous flux. And before I started to live in a self-imposed exile in Scotland, this was the kind of landscape I was literally responsible for in the Netherlands, you know, this kind of Dutch functional landscape. And I was a landscape architect of planning the regional landscape here. And I made a kind of conscious decision to escape this kind of straitjacket and to press the escape button and started to live in Scotland with the idea, without the notion that maybe landscape could become something different, that landscape could be maybe more about the sublime, that landscape maybe is more about art and philosophy and not just about a kind of functional deposition of organizing your territory. And when we started the Gross Max practice in 1996, we didn't have any work. And that was fantastic. And I was so glad that there's an economic crisis right now. And it's really good for young architects and landscape architects. Because if you don't have any work, you have time to think, you have time to write. And my God, you have to fight back. You have to fight your way back into the system. So you have to be kind of make a stance. So this was the kind of ourselves blundering ourselves into the profession, and we kind of were interested in the origin of the British landscape architecture. When we said landscape was really a part of a pure art, it was about visual experimentation, the art of the artifact, the cult of the cultivate. It's a landscape of hermits and dandies, and we kind of lost this in the last 20th century when landscape, even as a word, started to be kind of translated in the word environment, and landscape became a kind of monstrous green blanket and lost its kind of delicate green tissue. Two of my heroes, on one hand, Bacchus, the god of hedonism, heat of the moment, being extrovert, party. And on the other hand, Apollo, it's about rigor, structure, organization, architecture. And although I show them next to each other, I think the beauty of my profession of being a landscape architect is that we can reconcile those two opposites into one and each project. So they're they are extremes, but they can be reconciled. Another of one of our early statements in which we said that to be a landscape architect is look to a landscape in layers. Landscape is like a palimpsest, layer upon layer. And to be a landscape architect, you have to reveal those layers. You have to expose those layers. And maybe that in itself is quite compared to the act of striptease. And in order to do so, you have to be seductive, like Mata Hari, and you have to be sharp, like Miss Marple. So here we are, two of my other heroes. And Look, and this is of course not Miss Marple, but if I ever would make another Miss Marple episode, I would cast her and look to that hat. That hat is fantastic. If I only could have designed that hat, that is a piece of landscape I would never be able to
do better.
And of landscape is also always this kind of longing. It's always this kind of longing of the long lost paradise. This idea of Eden, paradise lost. It's you cannot ignore that it's always an underlying thought in any landscape project. And on the right, I really like this picture because at the moment we do quite a bit of work in Germany, and this picture isn't Germany. In fact, it's in Munich. It's the heartland of conservative Germany. You know, they are really boring conservative there. But look, give them a piece of greenery. This is called the English garden, and they behave like wow. You know, it's like being in paradise. So it's fantastic what nature can do. And of course, nature is also about the subconsciousness. It's about the kind of strains. And I think that some of the work and I think some of the important ideas in landscape also relates to the discoveries done by the surrealist. And this, of course, in collage by Max Ernst. These are two pictures of my photograph friend from Germany, Thomas Struss, and I put them together. He didn't put them together as a dialogue, but I put them together because it shows the kind of spectrum of being a landscape architect. On one hand, the jungle, hardcore nature; the other hand, hardcore city. And again, I would like to invite you not to see them totally as opposites, but even to consider what they have in common. And I, you know, cities are for me like jungles, urban jungles. And the way how plant grows towards the light is maybe not that different as the pieces of high rise. Even, you know, you don't have to be an architect to analyze even the pieces of architecture there are for different eras, they're kind of part of a different growth transformation process. And sometimes in our practice, we're using words or terminology from ecology and superimpose them on urbanism. So, for example, if you have a piece of wasteland, empty wasteland, the first vegetation who will colonize that wasteland we call pioneer vegetation. And over time, often this is monofunctional, strong species, and they're preparing the ground so that other plant species can move in and make it more complex, also in terms of architecture, in terms of spatial distributions and layering, a more complex landscape until you reach the states of what I would like to call climax vegetation. Now, the same ecological terminology you maybe can put on urbanism. So we're talking about pioneer urbanization transforming ultimately to a climax urbanization. And I would like to show you that in our Tempelhof project later tonight. Now, this is a painting I really liked. I only discovered this in my innocence about a year ago when I was teaching at and took my students to New York in Harvard. But a fantastic painting, you know, what a way of painting landscape. You know, the orchard on the foreground, that's the close-up, but still seeing the panoramic expanse of the wider landscape horizon. And of course, it's also still slightly seductive. It's still slightly even erotic. The birds, of course, likes to penetrate the flower and et cetera, et cetera. But what I like about this painting is that it's like, my gosh, it's like a deja vu. Have I seen this before? And the reason I asked myself that, because long before I've seen this painting, this was one of our very early Gross Max images. And so the idea of seduction and being overwhelmed, this is an organic orgy of orchids in a glass house in Rotterdam. And suddenly I had this kind of inspiration in retrospect. It's a strange world. What I'd like to do now is to show you very quickly just images of some of our projects. And then I will talk more in detail about some of those projects. And I'm kind of unashamed to show you those images because I think landscape is very much, for me, for Gross Max, a visual discipline. I mean, not making images purely to show the before and after. In fact, we are more interested in the in-between, so that the image is part of the project's exploration. Often we make those images at the very start of the project, long before we even start to consider how it looks in plan and section. So this idea and maybe the relationship to landscape painting or maybe even cinematic techniques about how you move through space and time, is for in the works of Grossmax very, very important. Of course, a lot of the work we do is competitions. Sometimes you win and lose. This is a competition we lost. This was for to making a monument for Princess Diana in Hyde Park. And we lost this competition because we put Prince Charles as a silky little boy in a pink shirt in the background, which was kind of picked up and not being appreciated by the British establishment at the time. This is an example of a project we just built in China as a kind of installation at an expo site. It's about a kind of shrine to the British plant hunters who went to China as hyperactive squirrels collecting many plants you find in your present-day garden centers. And this is a project we've done with the American artist Mark Dion, a fantastic artist. I think he's done one or two exhibitions in this city, and I would quite like I should not say, but I would like to apply for this Riverside Park competition and probably invite him to be part of a team. He's a fantastic guy. But this is a project we've done together in London for a vertical garden. It's a kind of stacked ecosystem on a very small site in the city of London. A lot of the work we do is to do with civic space. It's squares and hard landscapes. Sometimes we're not at all about plant material. It's about creating identities and atmospheres. Of course, parks is the icing on the cake. This is a competition we got second prize for Gleisdreieck in Germany. It's old railway lines, and we're trying to express the old railway lines in a kind of dynamic configuration in the forest. They become not flat, they become like treetop walkways, but also we've got meadows, experimental gardens, and at the same time, it's not only about nature, it's also about celebrating the urban edge of this park. A lot of the work we do, as I said, we got love-hate relationship with architects, but the reality is that we do a lot of work with architects, and one of our probably most constant collaborations for the last 10 years is with Zaha Hadid, which we collaborate in many projects across the world. This is a project for a railway station outside Naples in which we try to bring the Vesuvius volcano and the dynamics right into the shape of the architecture and the setting of in the landscape here. And another example of one of our slightly more serious projects, a master plan for Royal Botanic Gardens in Kew, in which we try to reconnect the Botanic Gardens with the River Thames. This I showed you as a little animation at the intro. Of course, some of the work is more provocative. It's about exhibitions and installations. And our real ambition is to work on an even bigger scale and get more engaged with the design, not only the planning, but I say design of regional landscapes. I like cities, and I like to look at cities as landscapes. And it's quite interesting. It's so difficult if you have a city to find a geological or even a soil map of cities. It's like it's all being written out of the scripts. But for me, although I don't like the word landscape urbanism, that is this new trendy terminology, kind of hybrid. I call it a Labrador poodle, which is a kind of hybrid between a poodle and a Labrador. So it's not a But the idea of landscape urbanism is a new thing. I think it's very old, but the idea of looking to cities like a landscape, this is London, the kind of city which you find most of our work. I find it really fascinating to look at cities like landscapes. And this map I really like. This is a 1944 map by Sir Abercrombie. It was about how to redesign London after the Second World War. But what I like about this map is that London, which is of course this metropolitan area, but it's actually an accumulation of villages. Each got their own core and their own identity, and all together they make this kind of beast called London. And I like this map because it reminds me about this picture. It's like a kind of ecological diagram which we're seeing cells, and each cell got its own core, and cells communicate in their periphery, and all those cells are making, an organism. So cities are like organisms. So if I talk about ecology and landscape, I try to talk in this sense about it. It's a slightly more scientific sense of ecological systems about organization and how cities are maybe very similar in their constructs. And cities, of course, are becoming networks. It's the kind of network cities. And I just put, I don't know too much about your city, but I just put this fantastic image I found about your city, Minneapolis and St. Paul's. I know you're kind of twin cities and you're always fighting each other. Kind of but I like this idea of the grid, of the urban grid and the natural systems and the lakes and this kind of strange kind of network, this overlay of man and natural systems. And even if we talk about the river products which being mentioned in the introductions, we really should put them and stretch them out into the bigger network of how those two twin cities are located in a natural construct, and also how you're actually in a transition from the higher ground with the limestones and the prairies. This is, you know, your city's in a fantastic geographic disposition, and you should be able to read that. And I must admit, yesterday when I arrived, I refused to buy a map. I'm too, you know, I'm Dutch. I don't like to spend, and kind of Dutch Scots is the worst. We don't spend any money, so I don't buy maps. So I just start walking, and intuitively I found a river. And I must say, until that moment, I was quite bored. I just came from Manhattan, and I was a bit not kind of overly impressed. But then when I hit the river and saw Antonio the waterfall. And suddenly I got it, you know, this whole place is grown out of this natural waterfall. And the city is evolved from that. But it's because of this piece of nature, and it's still that. And if it was a piece of nature, it would be pretty boring. But combined with this heroic man-made artifacts of the bridges and the mills, it becomes part of your culture and part of your history. So suddenly I got the place when I found that location. And that's no doubt why this river project is, it's so important to give yourself a geographic position and to give yourself a sense of place. It's fundamental. This is some of the studies we've done with Zaha, Hadid. It's trying to break away from the Cartesian grid of urbanism into a more fluid and a slightly more evolving way, a different way of trying to think about urbanism. Now I'm going to show you our best project first. So if you got bored with it, you know, you're invited to go home and do better things. And this is project, it's a very ecological project. So ecological that we didn't put any effort into it. So we didn't waste any energy, right? So we didn't make any drawings. We didn't even have a client, so we had no, you know, meetings. It's a found project. It's an object trouvée. And it is also quite handy for me because it's just around the corner where I live. So a lot of people think I'm an urban rat, that I live in a sewer. It's not true. I live in the countryside, I'm not stupid. And the project I would like to show you is this project. Look at those cubes in this landscape. That's the project. It's nearly like a piece of land art. Now, obviously, this project was a kind of result of the Second World War and the threat of the Germans trying to invade Europe, and in this case, the low-lying beaches of Scotland. But look what happens here. This fantastic kind of line, this land art line which runs through the landscape. And look what happens on top of this. And this is not designed, not planned, not drawn. This is purely a natural occurrence. And when I showed this product a little while ago in Vienna, the audience didn't get it. You know, they asked me, how did you do it? What's your planting plan? What's your maintenance regime? And all I could say is, you got it all. You got Wittgenstein, you got Freud, and you still don't got it. Yeah. This is a found product. It's a non-designed product, but it's as good as you get it. So Grossmax, only thing what Grossmax is documenting it and make it a kind of manifesto product, because it shows the kind of beauty about the juxtaposition of these Cartesian blocks of warfare and then the kind of colonization by nature, which is in its fragile beauty. And for me, it's very poetic. It's very beautiful. And also, you know, look at it. You know, this looks like a Chinese rock garden or a Japanese Zen garden. It's fantastic. And then how nature starts to break up things. So, you know, how can we do better? So sometimes we only have to open our eyes and find the projects instead of trying to reinvent. And one of my statements is, and that sounds quite, you know, maybe bold, but I think as a landscape architect, you would never invent a new project. All what we can do is reinvent something that is done before. And of course, even the concrete cubes, they're being poured. The concrete was poured in great haste because the fear of the invasion. The sand, they got the sand and the seashells of the beach. Even the concrete is very localized in its kind of, in its sits, in its condition of its work. And look at these. Now, I don't know if you guys know the Peter Eisenman Memorial in Berlin. But again, another proof that everything is done before, because it's already, you know, many years before it appeared in Berlin, it was in my back garden as a prototype. An example of a very tiny, more little installation project of our office. And it was the idea about, I always had the dream to make a weird project with plants. In fact, I would like to collect all the weirdo plants of planet Earth and put them in one glass house. Now, don't worry, it didn't happen. But I found a book which is called Design Against Nature by Huysman. Huysman is a French decadent novelist of the 1880s. And in his book Against Nature, the main character, Eisenstein, is a maverick collector. And in each chapter, he collects something. In one chapter, he collects plants. And the plants he collects, his criterion is that the plants should be real but look artificial. And so these are weirdo plants, you know, they smell of dust, they look like sexual organs, you know, the real freaky stuff. But they are real plants, you know. I went to the botanic garden, checked all the names in the chapter of these books with the plants in the library. And so the idea was to collect them all and put them in one glass house. Now, it's not totally a habit, but we built the glass house, and it's still a strange kind of folly, which has no utility. It's just a kind of strange kind of experience of plant life in this kind of setting. And it's all about depths and transparency and a kind of slightly mystery about what we're looking at. So this kind of installation projects, I can would be able to show you a kind of range of that, but this is just one example of the idea of just the beauty about landscape as a kind of non-utility. You know, often landscape is kind of predominated by trying to be functional and try to solve problems. This is an example which is maybe more relevant, even more relevant for the little competition at hand along the river here. This is a little park, only 1.7 hectares we designed in the city center of London. It's next to Tower Bridge. It's opposite the Tower of London. And it's adjacent to the Norman Foster designed Greater London Authority building. It's an example of a small neighborhood park which opens up to the river and becomes more like a belvedere overlooking the city of London beyond, on the other side of the river. So this project is about a kind of spatial transformation of going from the dense city of London and kind of embracing the river landscape. So it's a very simple scheme. It's Potterfield Park, that means this was a fields of pottery. They produced pottery here in the 18th century. I mean, and we did archaeological research and archaeological digs. We found elements of the pottery and some of those elements, like in this cast iron gate, they became part of the ornamentation. So it's still, in a kind of subtle way, make a kind of reference to the origin of the site. And what I say, it's a kind of viewing platform overlooking the city of London. It's a very simple design. We like to sit, like to see people sitting on the edge, not just on seats, but on the kind of stepped levels. Slightly kink in the composition, so you kind of guide it to the different view lines to create a sense of space. In a funny way, the greatest success of this park is not so much its design, it's the fact that we made it into a trust. And I'll show you some of the planting in a moment. The idea that also in London, as in many other cities in the world, that the kind of landscape has been taken away from all its little icing on the cakes, its plant material has been lost. But by making this into a trust and not making it part of the city establishment and the city maintenance regimes, we could appoint our own head gardener, and all the money which we generate in the park we can kind of reintroduce in the maintenance and introducing new products. And because of its very sensitive location, we actually create a lot of money out of commercial operations within the park. This is the building of the neighborhood park. And here we work with Pete Oudhoff. Now, probably you know Pete Oudhoff. He's a very good friend of me. He worked on the High Line. He did all the planting on the High Line in New York. And here we collaborated. Actually, slightly earlier than the High Line, we introduced him. Probably we are the first who introduced Pete Oudhoff in a kind of public landscape. And the idea that you really can introduce herbaceous planting and the grass as part of this more intensified experience of nature. And for me, this is interesting. I think that during the end of the last century, landscape was all about size. The bigger, the better. It was about big, sweeping, green space without kind of definition. But we quite like the kind of intensified hortus conclusus, the idea that you, in dense urban situation, you can create fantastical experiences of nature. Of course, it's quite funny to see a bit of American prairie planting in London. So it's the whole world, because it's still completely mixed up. But that's how we learn. And that's how we operate. And what we like to work with Pete, because Pete Oudhoff is a fantastic plantsman, but we like to give it shape. You know, that's the pathway, the hatches, and the way how we discuss our projects. It's a really nice collaboration. And this is what I was intrigued about. This is part of a cast iron gate, but it very much looks like the ornamentation Herzog Nemeron did as part of some of the details in this building. So it's probably a sign of the times. This I just kind of put in halfway, because we had a kind of strange discussion during lunchtime about the square below by Paul Friedman, and what to do with it. You know, should you get rid of it? Should you start afresh? And quite frankly, I couldn't make up my opinion during lunch, so I had a quick look after lunch too. And I think you should be careful. And I just put those two slides together, and it's probably not in the mind of the designer, but I like this idea that you got the core of this city is about the water and the waterfall, and then you got this fountain plaza. So I actually think before you start to reconsider to rip it all out and start all over again, you have to be careful. Now, I'm not saying you should keep it, because the situation has changed. And if the fountains would never ever work again, then forget about it. Just please rip it all out, because you would take away the heart of this project. But I somehow, intuitively, without having read about it, this is just my observation of seeing the two. I saw the river, I saw this images of this project, and I think there's a kind of correlation. But the reason I showed you is because the next project in London is we designed the landscape about the Royal Festival Hall, which is it's a bit the same. It's a modernistic building along the River Thames. And by the way, in London, we have much less modernistic buildings than you have in your city. But the thing was the same. What do you do? This was part of the Festival Hall of Britain. Do you restore? Do you? How do you deal with this kind of modernistic movement? And how do you respond to that? Now, our response was here to change, but with paying tribute to the past. So it's not like a big, you know, it's about, again, writing the other chapter, taking something of the past, but also make a move to the future. Intriguingly, by the way, that there's the London Eye and the piece of grass. We've done a competition there, and we lost against Adrian Geust of West 8. So I'm not coming next week. But we did a project next door, so we still, and the funny thing is, Adrian and myself, we were in the same class. When we were 18 years old, we started landscape architecture at the same school. So we still kind of, we are like ships passing in the dark, and here in London, we kind of cuddling each other with two products. But so the Royal Festival Hall, and it's an interesting building, because it's a theater, which is a box within a bigger box. And I like that, because a lot of theaters, maybe not the Guthrie Theater, although that's slightly hybrid, but this beauty about this theater is the inside space is like a public space. So you can walk there, and you only buy a ticket if you go to the inner box to go to the actual theater. So it's a beautiful inside-outside relationship here, and with also the terraces and the belvederes. So for us, it was very interesting as landscape architects to be part of a refurbishment of the theater and really think about the inside-outside flow. and most important about the relationship of the river. This is how we start, how the project looked like when we started. So we got this refined modernistic building of the 1950s, then the railings are actually more brutalist of the 1960s. We got a very ordinary slip road. We got a very dark underbelly of the building, a very mean piece of grass, and we kind of got a kind of non-space. But when we started to analyze the project, we discovered that the curve in the theater building is actually exactly the same curve as the River Thames. As soon as we rediscovered that, the whole project became very clearly that to extend the radius in the landscape and making this kind of big sweeping set of steps and landscape, suddenly the building, the landscape and the river were being reunited again. So it's a very simple move. We took away the slip road. We put commercial activities, which it's important to, it's about $1.5 million revenue each year, just purely because of the shops and the restaurants, what used to be the dark underbelly, the big sweeping steps which can be used for performance, and the whole curve geometry which relates to the shape of the building, of the river and the landscape. The columns kind of a reference to the past of the Festival of Britain. So very simple landscape, and I promise you, if you would be there, you will hardly notice it, and I have no problem with that. It's not shouting, it's not kind of banging your face. But because of the alignments between the building, the shapes in the landscape, it suddenly opens up back the relationship between the building and the river. And it is now one of the more successful, you know, gathering spaces to be on the south bank, the south side of the River Thames. This is the other side of the theatre. This is before we started, and this is how we reintroduce that in a more meaningful public plaza. So again, I'm not cannot talk of, for the Paul Friedman project, but I think you should take it serious and bring it forward, but not just kind of rip it out and start again. I think it's the kind of very subtle process of transformation you should consider that. And I'm very well aware that the theatre is not the same footprint as it is with its extension, but I think a careful, considered approach would be right there. Another project on the river, and I, you know, because Mississippi is on the river, I showed you, this is a project, I only show you one of our collaborations with Zaha Hadid. This is a transport museum along the River Clyde in Glasgow. A fantastic building, especially because it's a strange span. In fact, the building looked much better during construction than when it was finished. That is the drama of a lot of architecture. It actually looks better when it's unfinished. And it also, this building looks the best from the sky, which is, you know, we all like to be angels, but it's not always how we see things. And architecture is very simple as well, because Zaha, of course, what you do, you make your signature Z shape, you know, Zorro, Zaha, I was here. But I presume that the building expresses the confluence of two rivers. It's the River Calvin and the River Clyde. And I'm making a bit of jokes here, but I must say that the better project of Zaha did is once he, in a kind of abstracted way, can get an expression of the territory of the land. And most of her buildings, her good buildings, are all about movement. It's about how you move through it. So it's an interesting thing. And we were part of doing some of the setting of this building. It is not completely successful project, and it's maybe also something you should consider about your river landscape, because in Glasgow is still struggling. It's still struggling to reinvent itself after the closure of the many, many shipyards, and it's still not enough momentum. So even this project is interesting in its isolation. There's not enough momentum in Glasgow yet to really recapture the waterfront. Now, I think you're in a better position in your city, but to create this momentum, even I would say you, Jeanneval is one of my favorite architects, but even that building for me has not enough gravitas towards the river to kind of reawake the river. It's part of a process, but I think it should be kind of needs a follow-up. So some of the ideas of kind of breaking down the landscape and give the building a kind of setting. I go a bit quicker to win some time now to be able to present you the big Tempelhof project, but so it's kind of interesting, but it's a bit like nibbling along the edges. This is a project I quite like, because this project we done in a very industrial area in Germany, in the old mining areas. What was interesting about this project, it was actually an art project. So I was the only landscape architect invited to be part of this art commission. And each artist in this big piece of industrial landscape was invited to select their own site. That's fantastic. Often, landscape architects are given sites. This is your site, this is your brief, this is your program, this is your budget, off you go. To select a site is actually very interesting. So, and this was a collaboration with, again, Pete out of the plant, that's Plantsman. So we selected this site. We said, can we do this site? Because this was an old waterworks taken out of commission. And we thought the pure shapes of the two round basins, quite strong, you know. Even Renaissance gardens, you often see those two big circles, or often represent the earth and the celestial world. So it's a very kind of powerful thing. It also was listed, which is kind of intriguing as well. This was the first waterworks of this kind in this part of Germany. So it's actually a listed monument. So we said, although this is an art festival, we don't like to do a project which is a one-off, which is an installation which is being taken away. We only want to do a project which can have an after-use. So can we take this product and make it a part of a public park? So that's what we've done. And it's an intriguing landscape of motorways, railways, you know, suburban periphery, and kind of the Swissen start, the in-between city, but kind of, and then this kind of strange water basins. So our proposals here is to make one water garden and to make one sunken plants garden. So the water garden obviously reflects the sky, is maybe more about the celestial world, and a plants garden is sunken, is more about the earth. So it's a kind of, maybe in that case, a kind of abstraction. And this is only when we still were constructing, the plant still had to grow, but it's the idea of the sunken garden and the water garden. This kind of idea of this mysterious sunken garden which you would descend into and become into a kind of different experience. Circling in it, using some of the old infrastructure like this kind of drawbridge as part of the design. And opposite the water garden, which is very serene and very quiet. Now, those projects are still recently after construction, so I'm sure the plants looks even more special now. But the idea of this kind of celebrate, well, again, it's, you know, of course, Pete works on the High Line, so it's a kind of, in that sense, a similarity, but it's about sinking and drawing into this wonderful world of plants. And on the other hand, the water garden, with a light piece of light with circles around it. Another project, which I just added in today because of the situation I saw about the riverfront and some of the dereliction and how you go about it. This was a very cheap project. That's quite funny. When I had this lunch, I was being asked, you know, oh, but you're doing too expensive projects. And so I want to show you a very cheap project, you know, cheap tech. And this project was interesting because the red circle is about around an old Victorian hospital. And it's fantastic if you think about it. Normally, I complained about architects. And it's how often architects doing a building and taking away a piece of landscape, right? Now, this was the other way around, right? So here we could take away a building to create a piece of landscape. And that feels like sweet revenge. It was really, really good. So we took away this old Victorian hospital. This was not our idea to take it away. That was the brief. This is right bang in the campus of the university, the City University, Strathclyde. And they wanted to make a temporary garden. That was the brief, not a permanent garden, a temporary garden. Now the garden has been so successful that it's now become a fixed garden. In fact, it has become the core of the whole campus. But it was originally, and even the budget was meant to be for a temporary landscape. But to demolish a building, I promise you, is great fun. It's not easy. Not easy in terms of, you know, at what stage do you make the drawing, because it's like a continuous flux. But what we try to do here is to keep some of the structures and some of the retaining walls, and especially especially we were recycling some of the materials. Again, this is only after construction is much more flamboyant right now. But the idea is that we're using the topography of the site, a very steep sloping site, and again, creating something like a belvedere overlooking the city. I like the idea of belvederes. And if I would ever be asked to submit for the Riverside Park here, I think the Riverside is also about creating a belvedere. It's overlooking the river. And this was one, and here you see some of the walls, some of old, some are new, this rather theoretical flight of steps to work with the level difference. And also this image, when I showed this to the dean of the university, the dean said, "Can I make a comment?" And I said, "Yes, spit it out." And he said, "I like the product, but the girl..." I said, "What about the girl?" And he said, "The girl is too sexy." So in all the official publications of this project, we replaced this girl with a spotty, you know, red hair, you know, thick glasses, Scots laddie. And that was accepted. So if anybody wants to go to exchange to Strathclyde University, be prepared. So here we're dealing with the slope, in this case a south-facing slope, a bit of the inspiration, which is of course not directly from glass, but the idea of the walls and the terracing. And here we're building, and we're literally recycling the beautiful sandstone of the building, which would otherwise will go to a landfill, and recycle this in this gabion walls, and it gives quite nice warm-colored structures. And so we built the kind of project. The base of that. But this was a cheap project. Literally, in terms of money, this was about $800,000 or something like that. But it was not, for the size, a very cheap product. Also, the planting is a kind of more robust. I love students because they have time to do nothing. Yeah, fantastic. So there was a good client, you know, because you need people in parks. You know, I was in your parks. What is it called? God's along the river, you got your new park. Yes. And I kind of like it, but I was on my own, and that's not good enough for a park. So that park needs more activity, it needs more oomph, more program. And then towards the bottom of the park, where we collect all the rainwater, it becomes more natural and less designed, and nature takes over. And we got a kind of strange artifacts of remnants of the past as part of this design. And I repeat, this park is a very humble, low-budget, little intervention. And like the steps, they can be used by the students, and they use it in summer as open-air cinema and things like that. Right, two projects left. This is the one we're doing in China, Beijing. Now, China is crazy stuff. The project is in Beijing, and I really like Beijing. You know, this fantastic grid-like city. You know, you Americans think you invented the grid. You're not the only ones. And the Chinese, this Beijing, completely north-south. You know, very nice. And then in the center, the Forbidden City. You know, it's all about the relationship between the land and the celestial world. It's a very cosmographic diagram. And then surrounded like a horseshoe of hills overlooking the plain, so all right in terms of feng shui, etc. So how do you do a project in China? I mean, we do a couple of these. But here we were very interested in this kind of grid-like city surrounded by the natural mountains overlooking the plain. But the project itself is right bang in central business district of Beijing. It's where the high-rise towers are. And what we discovered, that the new generation of high-rise towers, they are in the order of 500-600 meters. And that is exactly the same height dimension as the first ring of hills surrounding the city of Beijing in a horseshoe shape. And we like this kind of analogy between the artificial skyline and a natural skyline. So that's, again, I talked in the beginning about zooming in, zooming out. That is the kind of nature of this project. And the highest tower of China, which will be built, is right in the extension of Orlinear Park. So basically, what we proposed is a mountain of this red metal beams that kind of like slices of a section of a mountain range, 500 meter long. They're sitting on a valley, and within the valley that's not designed by us, it's given in the brief, it's an underground shopping mall which otherwise open to the sky, but we kind of put this artificial canopy on top of it, and then we got a very idea of a long linear piece of forest landscape and a stream. And the whole thing is very simple, based on the notion that you cannot design a landscape in China without a mountain and without water. And this is the idea of the mountain range, this kind of sliced landscape, which obviously will look all different if you drive along the park in 60 miles an hour by car, if you walk in the shopping valley, or if you are in the elevator to the high rise, every angle will reach a completely different perspective of this of those slices, which altogether makes the mountain. And of course, we did our research in terms of, you know, how architects in history looked to mountains and started to draw mountains. Violette Le Duc, the French architects of the 19th century, this idea of this kind of triangulation, etc. And this is one, this is kind of funny because I kind of, in my university days, I was a kind of hardcore punk. And this was one of my favorite album covers by Joy Division. And I didn't really thought about it at the time, but you know, it must be completely subconscious because you must be able to see the reference between this image and our project. And then, of course, how the park sits in its wider landscape context. And then the idea that the woodland forest will bring down the scale of all the high rise, so you've got a more humanistic scale. And I'm quite intrigued about this forest. At the moment, we're working together with a very old man. He's in his 80s, and he's a really deep professor in plant botany of China, and he's part of our advisory team. So we are very serious that this forest really should look like a forest and sits next to this artificial mountain. And this is a kind of moon pond, which we like the idea that we project the different phases of the moon from the crescent till full moon will be kind of projected on this big 36 diameter pool. And the idea of the planting with sea, and the Chinese are crazy. So they want me next week to come to China to select the plants. And I expect to go to a nursery. No, they don't take me to the nursery. They take me to the bloody mountains. They're idiots, you know. They just want me to select plants in the wild. And then they dig them up. This project, I'm not joking. We won the competition in February last year, and then it was because the political thing, turmoil, putting new top 10 in China that filters completely through, new mayor of the city of Beijing, the new mayor has to sign off our project, it took 1 year. When it was signed off, they only gave us 3 months from concept design to all the construction details. Now, I'm serious, this project normally should take 3 years to design in detail. They wanted to have it in 3 months, they're like complete idiots. And this is the last project, so I hope you still have some patience. And in fact, this was what was advertised is the Tempelhof Airport project, which is probably in terms of size and maybe even prestige, the bigger project in our practice. It's a competition we won 2 years ago, which was a big European international competition to design a new park at the former Tempelhof Airport. Now, on this slide, I don't have a pointer, but where is it? I cannot jump on it, but it's even on the satellite photograph you can see it quite well. It's 360 hectares of former airport. Yeah, this slide, don't worry, I only use it once in Germany and then I decided not to do it anymore. You have to understand I'm Dutch, you know. But I tried to prove here that, of course, our airport is a very loaded site. I mean, it started off far back in the 13th century as a field of the Templars. It's called Tempelhof Airport. It always has been an open field for good geological reasons because of the moraine ice deposition. It's a very poor soil, slightly more exposed than the valleys in Berlin. So it's always not be good for agriculture. It's always been an open site for the Knight Templars or military operations. exercise or for airports. And before it became a military airport, it was the civic airport of Berlin in the 1920s. It was the airport of Europe, the crossroad of Europe in terms of airport. Lufthansa as a company was being founded on our side. And then, of course, in the 1930s, it became a military airport by the Nazis with a grandiose airport building, which is, I'll show you in a moment. It's this big crescent-shaped building. It's still the second largest continuous building facades in the world, 1.8 kilometers long of continuous building, embracing the park. But this was telling our client that nothing has really changed in terms that, of course, a project like this is all about politics. So here we're seeing the site, all this here on the bottom is the Tempelhof site. It's as big as the Tiergarten, the Linné designed forest. And we like this kind of analogy. On one hand, Berlin already got a city forest, and now we're going to give back a city meadow as a kind of complement to that. So it's a kind of site which gives you kind of, you know, sleeps without, it's a night without sleeps. You know, you get sometimes I wake up sweating at night, you know, my God, what are we going to do here? It's also quite a heroic site. I talked about the dark days of fascism. But after the war, when the Cold War started, the Russians at one stage in 1948 cut off all the land lines to Berlin. So the only way for more than a year the city would kept alive and going, at least the western part of the city, was by having this air bridge, the Luftbrücke. And our airport was the kind of the key site of where all those Dakotas, the Americans, the British, the Canadians, they all landed nearly every minute on our airport. So the airport has a very, you know, delicate history of good, heroic, dark. And, you know, of course, the question is how you deal with that. In a funny way, the jury afterwards, when we won the competition, in fact, the jury told us that they came to the conclusion after the jury that it was better to give it to a foreign company than a German company to deal with this kind of loaded layers of history. For me, very fascinating because my father was in aviation. So this idea of doing the transformation of an old airport would be, you know, my father died, but he would be very intrigued by that. And this is what the project is about. It's about embracing the void, the openness. You know, who is afraid for the urban void? And also, you have to imagine this building, this crescent-shaped building, is actually very all-embracing, but it's quite thin. So on one hand of this building, you are in the urban city of Berlin. This is the only airport I landed when it was still a working airport, which I walked to my hotel. It's right bang in the city center. So the other side of the airport building is completely urban. It's an urban square. And then you walk to this building, and suddenly, wow, it's a bit like the palace in Versailles, where you got the forecourt and you are in the city. Then you walk to the palace and then suddenly, wow, the horizon, it's all there in front of you. So we really like to play with this idea of the openness. And this is one of my heroes, Nietzsche, the philosopher, who actually made a very intriguing comment about the importance of having these spaces in cities which are this immense amount of openness and space, you know, areas for contemplation and withdrawal. Another of my heroes is the filmmaker Wim Wenders, which makes a fantastic film, which in German is called Himmel über Berlin, so the sky above Berlin. In English, it was regretfully translated as Wings of Desire. But it's about those angels which kind of hovering on the sky and trying to kind of go back on Earth and trying to be part of human life. But it's a fantastic film, which it's always has been in the background when we're doing this project. And this is the concept, and you know, landscape is very simple. You don't have to make it too complicated. So this idea of embracing this openness and circling it by this sense of activity, and it's literally our concept, the idea of activating the ads, making a dynamic, spiraling, overlapping ellipse, embracing and kind of framing the void. And this was one of our working models, which kind of started to express that. So this kind of circling movement, obviously north-south connections as well, keeping the east-west runways, and trying to, what we this is still quite rude. We did it more refined in the final design, but trying to express the shape and the scale of the building nearly as a piece of land art, engraving that into the terrain of the airport. Now, this was interesting because apparently of all the more than 100 entries, we were the only landscape architects who actually started to address the building. And even in the jury, we were seriously questioned about that. They asked me, you know, in the final presentation, how do you dare to celebrate a fascist building? And I said, no, it's not about celebrating a fascist building. It's about two fingers up. You know, Hitler will turn in his grave. You know, this building will become part of a public park full of arts, events, and manifestations. This is a completely public landscape. This is, but obviously the building is there, and you could not treat it like an elephant in the room and ignore it. So, and even if we would take the building out of the composition, we kind of end up with kind of an empty shell. So for us, it was a kind of interesting thing. The other thing what you see here, they were not really part of the competition, but we also started to redesign different urban quarters around the park. And since we won the competition, we also appointed, together with urbanists, to reconsider some of the urban quarters around the park. So the simple plan and expressing that. For us, it was very important. If you look to a park like this, you have to think about the park as part of a bigger structure. It's the same, I would say, about there's a golden rule in landscape. We are megalomaniacs as landscape architects. If this is your site, you just make it as big as you can. So, you know, if we would ask to do this tiny little park along the river here, we make it as big as possible, at least as a conceptual idea. And a park like this is all about, in fact, you don't need to do anything in this park. In fact, what you have to do is to interweave it back into the urban fabric. And it's all about reconnection. So this park becomes part of an urban network and a green structure. So we did as much as emphasis in showing how this park could become. And here we designed a lot of new connections out with or competition entry to show that if we connect this, then it becomes part of ecological corridors, recreational corridors, but also more environmental issues. Berlin is a very interesting city that they have serious studies about how cold air, now, I know you guys don't like cold air, you like warm air, but in this case, how cold air moves through the city. And so it's part of a quite a scientific way of looking at green structures in a bigger strategic scale. Obviously, it's all about facing. It's this is the other thing. Everything is done before, you know. This is, of course, a fantastic example in Bath. The idea that a crescent-shaped building really can capture a landscape and really can hold it. The landform, by the way, is much more subtle because although the site is flat, and I'm from Holland. I like flat. Gives me comfort. I'm quite happy that your city is quite flat, but still it tilts away. Over the many hundreds of meters, it tilts away a couple of meters. So the landform starts level and remains like a datum. So it's horizontal. The top of the landform, the circular landform, remains horizontal. But because the land dips away, it becomes a piece of land art. But so it's quite subtle how it actually reveals the lay of the land and then extends into the shape of the former airport building. The other thing is the idea, I showed you now the kind of diagram of the Gestaltung, the overall shape. But very much part of this project is to see the park as a process. So on one hand, we think we need a strong shape to deal with all the uncertainty. But at the same time, the project is very much based on inviting people, we call them pioneer users, to occupy pieces of land in the periphery of the park, to activate the edge. They're already there. People of Berlin can make propositions, and then they can, if they are interesting, they will be agreed upon. And then organizations get their own piece of land, and they can kind of construct their own project. So you get this weird, slightly anarchic way of strains. And Berlin, of course, is full of artists and full of very rebellious kind of youth culture, but they become kind of part and drivers of the project. Now, this is not an easy process. It's a bit like a Trojan horse as well, but it's kind of interesting. So the idea that the park is not an object, but a process, and these are some diagrams which are equally important as the actual master plan drawings, which is trying to describe the green is the urban transformation from pioneer to climax, and the red is the pioneer users, urban users, which also transform over time into a more stabilized, complex situation. So it's a kind of transformation of nature and social conditions, which create the shaping of this park over many years. So, and we're talking about a park that will be shaped, not built overnight, although we constructing the first part this autumn. It will be a project of about 5, 10, even 20 years. This I really love to do, but again, it's written out of the script. They forbid me. I was not allowed. Little Red Baron, you know. Is it not Snoopy? Is not Snoopy the American Snoopy? You've got the Little Red Baron with his little show. I'd love to be him. You know, I want to be, you know, the Little Red Baron. And then this is my planting plan. it's really true. I mean, I made this joke many times before, but the Germans, you know, they are so strong in their ecological moralistic approach. I called the word, it's the only contribution I did to the German landscape architecture profession, is I invented the word ecological Taliban. They are like, the ecologists are like Taliban. They you know, there's no arguing with them. And one of the big statements I made, which is like swearing in church, I said, we don't believe in landscape conservation. Wow, boom. I said, we believe in landscape activation. We can activate nature, we can create nature, we can kick nature in the ass to be even more productive and even more beautiful and more flowering and even more attractive to butterflies and bees and things like that. And of course, we don't do that as a joke. We do that very serious. We work with some of the best ecologists from the TU in Berlin, and Piet Oudolf is the fourth from the Netherlands. We got an international advisory team in how we can activate that meadow. But this was the original idea, kind of Jackson Pollock kind of planting plan. And this is more Albrecht Dürer, of course, the famous, but the idea that we have a piece of grass and we can activate it and make it even more special. Some of the architecture, we worked with some Sutherland Hussey architects of our hometown to do some of the architectural pieces with Grossmax. And the idea of being inspired by shapes and forms of the airport, and in this case, this will become beehives, utilizing their structures. Ideas of birds watching, and again, celebrating the openness. It's fantastic how the people of Berlin have colonized this space for all this kind of active use. So it's a really already without design, a fantastic park. In fact, that is the big discussion. I have serious discussions. I mean, the last public consultation, they're so vocal, the people of Berlin, the last public consultation about this park, we had 600 people in the audience. So that, you know, you are tiny compared to that. And then they want to discuss your park. It's like mayhem. And of course, a lot of people ask the questions, why do we need your park? Why do we need your park? And what do you answer? You know, the more activating of the air, the traditional park, I go a bit quicker. The idea of using the airport ground is 28 hectares of concrete in front of this airport. We're using that concrete and the airport roof to collect rainwater and make that into water bodies. Originally, we proposed to make the biggest natural ice rink. I know you guys are always complaining about the weather, you know. How do we make a park when it's cold 8 months of the day, of the year? You just make ice rinks. Enjoy the winter. You know, there is not something as bad climate, it's just about different climates. And this was kind of intriguing because of all this flatness and all this wide expanse of openness, we wanted to create one vertical element. And Berlin is full of monuments for war, and we wanted to create a monument for nature, for Alexander von Humboldt, which is the kind of German Darwin of Germany of the 19th century naturalist. So we created this idea of having this one vertical rock monument with the idea that this is the diagram of this von Humboldt. He discovered plant geographies in different altitudes, and so or kind of monument is kind of inspiration on that. And the idea on the inside, it would be hollow and it would be the biggest most fantastic climbing school in the city of Berlin, and we did our economic research that there is indeed a fantastic demand to having this kind of climbing school with the light would fall through the shafts. So all this was in our mind. And then I did a big presentation to the client and said, here it is. I've been chiseling away for the whole summer. You know, I know I'm not cheap, but you know, I took my time and here is it. And the funny thing is, and this is quite recent, I just found this on my beach, you know. It was just a present of the sea. I just found it, and I was so happy. You know, this thing is about this high. At the moment, right now, I'm scanning it into a 3D scanner. So that means I have all the cat drawings. Again, very ecological sound. I don't have to waste any time, because I'm going to build this 60 meters high in this place. Because, I mean, look at it. I mean, it's much better. I mean, this looks quite awkward, you know, quietly even too phallic and things like that. It's just not good. And look at here, you know, here, you cannot beat nature. So this is what we're going, this is what we're going to build. And build the client. Here we are. Yeah, you have to be careful to consider me for a commission. And of course, this is again embracing all the openness. And the water is the recycling of the water coming from that big existing concrete roofs and four fields. Some idea of bridges, some of the details, and some of the idea of the urbanettes can transform it. And very finally, and this I done actually by kind of coincidence. I showed you the painting of Ruisdael, my hometown, and then I just paste or propose it for Tempelhof next to it. And it's only when I started to do that, I started to see a kind of maybe strange resonance of reconnections. The only thing I've left, I don't know if it's time, it's only 3 minutes, it's a little animation, which we maybe can show you. And then I would like to thank for your immense patience. I know it's a very dark side, Tempelhof. Thank you. Great, thanks. Of course, I'm willing. If anyone's have a question, I'm here.
It's already on. Will you stand?
It seems to me that in a lot of your projects, you're maybe even primarily interested in revitalizing urban environments to attract social activities to sites that are maybe presently lacking that those types of activities. And I'm wondering whether or not, I'm wondering how that enters into your selection of projects and how you factor in the commercial aspects of some of the projects you've mentioned.
Commercial
if
aspects?
That makes sense.
I just came from New York before I came here to have a meeting with my client from hell, which in this case Goldman Sachs. So yes, maybe I'm not the best one for commercial products. I think you have to be. This is, by the way, something I learned even today in a different way. Like I had a kind of lunch with some people of the city from different backgrounds, from business till community activations or the museums, and they all had one thing in common: they really wanted to make a change in the city. So I like that. I like this idea that you have common ground, and it's amazing that. Many this type of meetings I have in Europe, they're kind of in this bubble of designers and doing the design type of thing. So I what I like about what I learn about America, and I think, for example, the High Line is one of the quintessential products of the last decade, full stop, in the profession of landscape architecture. It's a good example if you analyze how that project came about by the initiative of people and the funding. And so I think this is something I definitely can learn from what happens here. But the but activities are important. You know, we making product. I like to open people's eyes. I like to, and maybe even tonight, I like to tease a bit. You know, I don't think we always have to give what people want. Automatically, because that people want what they want is cliches, things they have seen before. We have to take them on a journey. Sometimes we do that very serious. For a very tiny community project in London, we took 20 black kids and we took them to Barcelona on a very serious study tour, which was filmed and became an exhibition, and really started to make a change in that community. So I think you have to open up people's eyes. But we have to activate landscapes. You know, you have to kind of kiss them alive. Even what I saw here in over the last 2 days in your city, I spent my time to watch the waterfront and things like that. And you need to create a momentum of activities and programs. And I know it's a bit not really kind of correct words to talk about brandscapes or things like that, but I think landscape is also about eventscapes. And if anyway, I don't think I've shown enough about that tonight. I mean, tonight I concentrated more on the visual imagery, on the kind of backing up or ideas. But and also, I'm a great believer that people are very inventive. You know, you don't have to kind of patronize people. You know, that's the fantastic things. In Berlin, that space is already occupied, colonized by people. You know, human beings are like animals. Give them an opportunity, and people started to respond to this opportunity. So give them a piece of land, like in this case, the former airport. When we done the competition, it was still fenced off. And then during the competition, it was literally opened up to the public, because the public demanded it from the city, that is, the fence should go away, it should be opened. And the way how they use it is incredibly inspiring. They do things which people could not imagine. And there are conflicts which everybody thought there would be big conflict, and somehow they kind of resolved. I don't think it's perfect. It's a bit still the survival of the fittest, you know, like, you know, what about the old people and the young kids, you know. So to make a democratic landscape is not just, you know, let all hell break loose. But people are engaging, and people are powerful in putting their thoughts and ideas as part of projects. And we learn from that. I can show you projects which we've done in the past, which are really beautifully designed, but were not successful because they were too much parachuted into a community. They were not part of the of a bigger process of regeneration. I'm not saying that we, in a funny way, I think that me coming from Europe can learn a lot of lessons for what happens in America, because what we have in Europe at the moment is that we, a lot of our work by definition is public work. I don't have many private clients. I got one very interesting one. He's a guy who's the first guy who went to space as a tourist, and he got so much money that I'm really, you know, I'm meeting him for my first presentation in 2 weeks' time, but it would be fantastic. But it would be our first really kind of weird private garden. But nearly all our projects are public projects. And of course, in Europe, the public crisis, the crisis in the economy really has affected the idea of public works. And I think a lot of eyes are now opened up to America in a way how you do fundraisings, even in a museum like this, you know. I don't want to kind of, you know, I love to see arts in the museum, but also this museum shop in this museum is one of the better museum shops I've seen in a long time. And, you know, why not? It doesn't hurt anybody, and you make a commercial enterprise. So I think in Europe we actually can learn a lot of this kind of American way of also to deliver products. So I would not have the total answer to that. I also am here to learn in that sense.
I'm glad that you got down to our riverfront. I think it's one of our jewels.
It is. Yeah.
Did you get a chance to walk across the Stone Arch Bridge? And what did you see?
Well, what I see, and I said that during lunch, what I saw, which is fantastic about the stone, first of all, the shape is beautiful, and the contrast between the waterfall and then the shape. But what you see, it's a good example there. And I think this is going to change big times in the United States over the next decade. You see a piece of infrastructure which is only for pedestrians and cyclists and people with skating and things like that. And they really occupy it. It's a fantastic experience. And what is more problematic is how do you bring people to the river? You know, you even got car parks. You got, you know, fantastic riverside things, and you put cars there. You got car parks everywhere. You still allow the odd, and you know, so bite the bullet and bring people to that river and allow them also on cycle. And because you know you're a bit like Holland, you're pretty flat here. You can cycle even much more, and I think that will happen. I mean, I've no idea. There's so many trends coming from America, which is about guerrilla gardening. It's about re-interest in health. There are people. It's an underlying current that you're still having this kind of longing for the American wilderness. It's a kind of still a kind of public outrage that you actually want to break away, but you're still getting this kind of straitjacket of the car-driven, grid-like cities. But I think by opening up the river, reutilizing those old infrastructures, like the old railway bridge, is now becoming this fantastic thing, much more successful than a new park, by the way. And I don't want to talk bad about the park, because I think it's an interesting piece of design, but it shows you the power of something, of reconverting something existing, and then raises the imagination. So I think it's a fantastic opportunities you have there. But I think the trick now is to reconnect that to the wider urban fabric and see that as part of a park system. And you have been good in park system, because when I was there, what you got there is a park drive. But that's, of course, a concept of the 1930s, you know, of having the park drive, you know, driving in your car. I mean, I quite like that. I can put Elvis Presley on the things and have my convertible and drive your parkway and have a great time. But I think we kind of moved on from that. You know, you don't have the Elvis Presleys, you don't have the nice convertibles anymore anyway. So, but now I was pleased by seeing the river. It's a powerful landscape. And of course, in Britain, we also have having this industrial landscape. But what I liked about it is how man meets nature. And you can dream away. I mean, I of course, I'm not part of this part of the world, but I can imagine Indians having their camps there. You're part of it. You know, I wouldn't say that we are hypersensitive as landscape architects, but as soon as you're in a place like that, you feel vibrations like this is quite powerful, and then you really should utilize that big time. Yes, shout.
Okay, so a lot of your projects are very bold and very attractive and incredibly intriguing, especially to a crowd like this. But when you talk about taking parking lots away from the riverfront and embracing the wild landscape, although that concept is embraced by this type of crowd, the general public doesn't buy into it as easily. And so I would really like to hear about clients who you have had who you never thought you would change their mind, or whose mind seemed very much in opposition to what you were trying to do.
It's a difficult one. I would love to give a lecture once, which I only show pictures of my clients and then talk gossip. It would be. And I got clients from hell, including the Goldman Sachs. It's a strange business. I mean, a lot of our work, by its very nature, is doing competitions and trying to win competitions. It's a big part of our work. Even with some of the top architects like Zaha Hadid, a lot of the projects we built with her are actually the result of winning competitions. So this is not totally answering your question, but it becomes a bit self-fulfilling prophecy. If you win in competition, the client has already selected you because of a certain set of values or recognition of ideas. So in that sense, things are even getting easier in a funny way than in the earlier days of my practice. You slowly become more part of a kind of network where you. So that's. But of course, we also do a lot of other things. And I'm not only doing my practice, I am in many advisory committees. I'm just being appointed to be an advisor of the Mayor of London in terms of architecture. I've done it for many years in Scotland. And of course, every year, every time I have to fight a battle. And for landscape architects, in a funny way, it's also the architects. And again, I repeat, love-hate relationship. I have to convince architects what landscape architects can do, and that projects could be conducted in a different way. So it's a battle, but it's not just the client. It's your colleagues and things like that. And what I learned, and this is kind of interesting. Public consultation in Britain is quite tough, but it's quite extensive, much more extensive than my home country in Holland. And really tough. I've been in tough areas in London where people really start to shout to you. You know, we don't want your bloody trees. We want jobs. You know, that kind of stuff. But I also discovered that the general public is your biggest ally to convince politicians, because politicians are often quite easy to change their minds and be quite opportunistic. But as soon as a general public is behind your project, you are very powerful. And that I discovered in several situations, that we really had to have a fight, like a battle for the hearts of the general public. But as soon as we had the general public, we started to build up momentum and create better projects than we could ever achieved in the first place. Some of our projects, I mean, most of our projects are public projects. And public projects, by definition, are very political. You know, even Berlin, it's a snake pit of you know, Christian Democrats, Social Democrats, God knows. So it's not even the kind of one client you have to convince. You have to kind of more influence a process. And sometimes we lose. But I'm a great believer. Even clients, they want... You have to open up people's eyes. You have to inspire. You know, you have to be enthusiastic. You have to believe in what you do, and you have to take people on the journey. And most clients, they actually don't know what they want. Most weakest part of every project is the actual design brief. They're often like camels. You know what a camel is or not? A camel is a racehorse designed by committee. And most design briefs are like that. They're designed by committees. They're kind of full of paradoxes. And to kind of shoot through that and to really kind of take the client and the project on a journey, what the project would like to be, or even more important, what the site likes to be. Forget about the client. Forget about the budget. What does the site like to be? It's Louis Kahn, the American architect, who kind of provocatively asks, what does a brick want to be? Now, that's a kind of stupid question, you know. Brick doesn't want to be anything, you know. Wants to go home and watch television or something like that. But in terms of landscape, it's a very relevant question. What does a landscape want to be? You know, I don't, again, want to sound like a bloody Dutch moralist, you know, there's already too many of them, but there is this very relevant question. What does the landscape want to be? It's not about political ideas. Most politicians are only there for four or five years, and they're gone. So what does the landscape likes to be, or wants to be, or could be? So our clients are just a kind of handicap, something we need to have to do projects, but they're actually not our main consideration.
Yeah, I was wondering if you had a couple examples of successful landscapes and how you activate them using events or programming or other methods.
Right. I think there are many actually. I think I'm not talking about myself, but the idea of using landscapes as event space is a very intriguing one, and it's like also crossing boundaries. I mean, of course we got cliches like we got a museum, we got a sculpture garden, but you know, here you got the new Jean Nouvel building, a theater, but it still sits in a kind of mysterious, literally black box or dark blue box, and so how you can turn things inside out. How can you have the kind of creativity which happens indoors, how you can create them outdoors? And the world is changing, you know, on many levels, you know. 5 years ago, I couldn't buy a decent cup of coffee in London before the Starbucks invasion. But city hopping, difficult thing to talk about marathons right now, but the idea, there's a lot of city are becoming events. And I think we as landscape architects can learn with that and could design more accordingly. But I think the natural tendency of the growth of city as cultural places where people want to, it's quite interesting, you know. And maybe in America it's even more disastrous change than in Europe. But people are not going to shop anymore, at least not in Britain. You know, you do everything on the internet. The whole idea of the high street, well, you probably never got one, but it's changing. Cities are really changing in terms of program. But the idea that you come to cities to meet people, which you cannot do on the internet, only in a virtual way, that you go to cities for cultural events, that you go for cities for city breaks, that you go, you know, I can go to Minneapolis for 2 days and see this fantastic Walker Art Center, and then go in the evening to the Guthrie Center, and then having a walk along the fantastic Saint Antonio waterfall. You know, programming that and marketing a city like that, I think it's very, very important. And the one thing we proposed is, I don't think it's going to happen, but we seriously proposed as part of a competition for Tempelhof. We said, this park needs a curator. Each year, you should appoint a curator. One year, you should appoint a filmmaker, Wim Wenders. The next year, a fashion designer, Golsi Cabana. And next year, you should appoint a scientist like Professor Hawkins. Appoint curators and give them the kind of opportunity to create a park of this magnitude. So I'm a great believer that activating and programming and creating events works. But I repeat, you know, if I go to, you know, again, if you look to your country, you know, I'm more often in New York, but, you know, Bryant Park, which was a dump 10 years ago, is really, you know, design-wise, I would say it's a bit boring, it's a bit like classical and thematical and things like that, but it really works. And in this context, it works. Central Park is fantastically reanimated. The High Line is a fantastic example of a really clever project where people really want to be, not only... I thought it would never work. I remember talking with Pete Audhoff. It's not going to work. Who wants to be on a bloody High Line in New York, in the Meat District, and you walk, and there's no escape. And, you know, I had this kind of idea that you would be followed and pickpocked, and that is a kind of, would be this kind of urban kind. And it is fantastically successful. It is. So... I think there are actually quite many examples, and I think to show them to city leaders and things like that would be interesting. But we have to open our eyes, and sometimes, you know, I'm talking to you as a landscape architect because that's what all I can do. But a lot of our work and a lot of my ambition is collaborations, and to break, you know, filmmakers, artists, musicians, scientists, you know. There is a world to capture there.
As a student who's about to graduate, I'm wondering what you've learned over your career so far that you wish you knew when you started out. Like, are there lessons or ways to adapt to the changing world around us that any wisdom to share with us?
No. I tell you something which I did before I went to study. I worked in a circus, and I was training animals. It's not funny because now I'm teaching in Harvard, training students. It's quite similar, actually. But I learned a lot of lessons there. So I don't think you school kind of prepared for too many things, which is not to say bad about schools. I think that's the way it is. But what I find important in my dream is that that landscape practices or any of our, you know, business should at least have an identity. So if you are a client or whatever, you know, you hire somebody because there's a certain set of beliefs or a certain set of ambitions. So I'm not a great believer of this over-the-top, commercialized, you know, this kind of approach to a profession. I think that I'm not just, I understand that happens, but I'm not interested. So we never ever treated our own business as a commercial practice. And quite frankly, how did I survive? By literally doing teaching in the early days. But the funny way, because we never done it as a commercial practice, so we never done the out-of-town shopping markets and the car parks and the malls, it's kind of been quite, in a roundabout way, quite successful. Because we did competitions, we won some, and it became more international. And now I'm still a very small practice. We're only less than 15. And we do what we believe in. And I have quite great fun. It's much more fun than being a student, because as a student you have to do what your tutors believe in, which is very boring. And now I can do what I believe in myself, so I feel much more comfortable.
We'll take one more question if there is one.
Good. It's all dried up.